Okay, then maybe we can slowly start, and in the meantime, I guess that the people will come from breakfast. Okay. So, yeah, good morning. Thanks for waking up. Okay. So, okay. So let's see. So in these lectures, today and tomorrow, I want to tell you about different aspects of tensor networks, and today is going to be very introductory. So you already have at least three introductions on different aspects of tensor networks, one by Glenn. His first lecture was also very introductory, also Mari Carmen and also Masaki, so they also mentioned several things, but what I would like to do, at least today, is to go a little bit more into some details, but still being at the level of an introduction, okay? So, because I think that there are some key results that are important to know, okay? They are very basic, some of them are just basic quantum mechanics, and some others are like very basic results of matrix protest states, but these are important to know, and it's important to see the derivation at least once in your life, and then you just, okay, you know it's there, and you keep on going, okay? So this is what I would like to do today, and therefore today I will be talking a little bit about, you know, general results of entanglement, a few definitions that I think are important, that maybe they were not stressed too much in the last days, or they were just mentioned very, very quickly. And then I would like to move to matrix protest states, again, define what they are, what is the motivation to find these states, what are some of their properties, and then I would like to show you a typical calculation with matrix protest states at the analytical level, which is to show how is the correlation length of a matrix protest state, okay? And then, well, we'll see whether we keep on going with something else or not, okay? And that's my plan for today. And for tomorrow, I want to go into something else. I want to go into two-dimensional systems. And then you will see that the tensor networks that we'll be using suddenly become very, very complicated, especially to paint on the blackboard. I mean, it's not that they are complicated, but they are difficult to paint, okay? So I will not be using the blackboard anymore, and tomorrow I will be using the projectors, and there will be lots of diagrams with many colors, okay? So, tomorrow will also be fun. Okay, so just to have an idea, how many of you have had some course at some point on quantum information or something like that? Will you please raise your hand? 2, 3, okay. And how many of you have programmed something with matrix protest states at some point, something like the MRD? Okay, so many people doing MPS, but not knowing about quantum, okay. And how many of you have done something with another type of tensor network that is not a matrix protest state? Say, for instance, something with PEPS. Who has done something with a PEPS? Oh, that's quite a few, okay. And something with a MERA? Okay, a couple of three. Okay, very good, okay. So, good. Then, well, that was more or less to have an idea. Okay, so let's get started. So the title of today, I mean, today is the lecture one, and the title was From Qubits to Entanglement, and then to Matrix Protest States. It's a very generic title, and well, I could explain many things here. First, I would like to start by giving you some references that I think they are useful to study entanglement, to learn about entanglement in quantum many body systems, and also a little bit about the background of tensor network methods. There are many, many reviews, okay? And the ones that I'm just putting here, I mean, these are not by far the only ones, but these are kind of representatives, so some references, which are always useful. There is a review by James Isert, and I give you the archive number, that's 1308.3318. It's published somewhere, but I was too lazy to have a look at. You can just have a look at the archive number. There is another one by Norbert Schuch, which is archive 1306.5551. Now, there are a couple of papers by me, okay? One is 1306.2164, and there is another one which is archive 1407.6552. Okay, and then, that's fine. There are also two or three reviews by people like Thirak and Verstraete. And this one, I don't have the right number, I have the published, the journal. It's a Journal of Physics, Journal of Physics A, 42, or what else, 504. 004004. This is a review from 2009. There is another one by Verstraete, Thirak, and Valentin Moore, which is under Advanced Physics 57, 143, 2008, and concerning matrix protostates, there is a very nice review. Well, there are two very nice reviews by Ollie Shorebook. But I give you the reference for one of them, which is the one that is more related to matrix protostates. That's Annals of Physics, 3-6, 96, and this is from 2011. Okay, so if you want to learn more about the basics, you can just take a look at these papers, okay? There are more reviews, okay? But these ones are good places to start with. Very good. So let's start from the basics, and I want to start talking about entanglement. Okay, and probably all of you know what is the definition of entanglement, but just for, you know, for completeness, so that we know what we are talking about, let me define what entanglement is, okay? So given a quantum state for two parties, A and B, this could be two qubits, or it could be a block of a many-body system versus the environment, or the interior of a black hole and the rest of the universe, okay? So we have two parties, psi AB, and this, well, this belongs to some Hilbert space, the two parties, that is the tensor product of Hilbert space A times space B, very basic quantum mechanics. We say that this state is entangled, okay, if and only if the following happens: psi AB is different from a quantum state for A, tensor product a quantum state for B, with quantum state A in a Hilbert space A, quantum state B in a Hilbert space B. Okay? That's the definition of bipartite entanglement. Okay? Entanglement between two parties. There are several comments here. So entanglement can also be multipartite. You can also define it for, I don't know, for three qubits, okay, or for three parties, or for 25, or for 10 to the 23, whatever you want. And then you can define different types of separability. Okay, separability is, you know, the property of being a tensor product. Okay, now this is the simplest definition of entanglement, just the bipartite one, and it's going to be the one that we'll be using. Okay, very good. Of course, I'm just being very brief, but this is the main idea. And now, what I would like to explain to you is about bipartite pure states and the Smith decomposition. Okay. So what I want to show you now is that there is a particular decomposition of bipartite states, okay, like the one that I just wrote, that is called the Smith decomposition. And this Smith decomposition is associated to the singular value decomposition. And then you can make the connection to tensor networks, because we all the time use the singular value decompositions. Okay? But this is the reason why we are going to be using SVDs all the time, because it comes from the Smith decomposition. So this is the idea. The decomposition says that given a quantum state psi AB, like the one that I just wrote, and well, I just write it in terms of some basis. This is psi ij, these are the coefficients, and then we have some quantum state for I, for A, sorry, and another one for B. This is an arbitrary state in this bipartite Hilbert space. So there is a theorem that says that there is always a decomposition such that I can create my state like psi ab equals sum for alpha equals 1 up to a number that I call chi, and this should start ringing a bell, okay? And then, well, some numbers lambda alpha, and then some vectors alpha for a, alpha for b. With the following properties. So first, these states are orthonormal basis for a and b. So alpha, alpha prime a, this is equal to alpha, alpha prime for b, delta alpha, alpha prime. So they are orthonormal bases. Then the lambda alphas are real and larger than zero. And that's it. Okay? There is always such a decomposition. Now in this decomposition, the lambda alphas are called the Schmidt coefficients. Chi is the Schmidt rank. And I didn't say that, but chi is upper bounded by the minimum of the dimensions of the Hilbert spaces, okay? With Ea the dimension of its A, and Bd the dimension of its B. And these vectors here, so alpha for A, or the set of vectors alpha for B, these are called the Schmidt bases. Okay. So I give you a second to copy. Question so far? No? Everything is clear, no? Yes?
This is a unique decomposition.
Well, it's unique up to faces, up to redefinitions of these vectors. Okay? But the point is that the interesting thing about the Schmidt decomposition is that we go from just an arbitrary, you know, representation of the quantum state, where we have a sum over two indices because we have two bases, to something where the bases are actually correlated. Okay, we just have one index labeling both bases, and it's going to be, you know, vector one from one basis with vector one from the other basis, vector two from one basis with vector two, and so on. So there is just one index. Okay, so the both bases are correlated. Now this number chi will turn out to be very interesting because, as you can imagine, this will be the bond dimension of my tensor net. Okay, and some people call it D, some people call it M, depending on the situation. Here I call it chi. Very good. So this is the Schmidt decomposition. The lambdas are called the Schmidt coefficients, and yeah, this is what it is. This is a very, yeah, very well known theorem in quantum information science. Now, before proving it, let me mention a lemma that I think is quite representative of why the Schmidt decomposition is interesting, which is that if this Schmidt rank is equal to 1, this happens only if and only if the quantum state AB is separable. Okay, separable means not entangled. Okay? And this is great, because if I just give you an arbitrary quantum state and I tell you, well, is this quantum state entangled or not? I mean, you can just try by inspection, but here there is an operational procedure, okay? If you are able to compute this Schmidt decomposition, then you just have a look at how many terms you have in this sum. And if there is only one, it means that the state is a product state, okay? And if there is more than one, it means that the state is not separable and therefore it's a tangent. Okay? This is the reason why the Smith decomposition is important to study entanglement. Later I will tell you that this Smith coefficient actually is also a measure of entanglement, okay? In the sense that, well, if chi is equal to 1, then the state is not entangled, but if it is larger than 1, then the state is entangled, okay? But, as you can imagine, well, the problem is that it's discontinuous and so on, but we'll go through it later. Okay. Okay. Good. So now let me prove the Smith decomposition. Okay? Let me just prove it. So proof of the Smith decomposition, let's call it SD. Well, we just start with this quantum state AB, and this is sum ij psi ij I for A, J for B. And now I just pick up the coefficient of the quantum state, and well, it has two indices, okay, and something with two indices I can understand it as a matrix, right? So this psi J, I just understand it as a matrix, and I call it matrix psi. Okay? And once we have a matrix, well, I can do many things with a matrix, and one of the things that I can do is a singular value decomposition, this you know very well. Okay? So the SVD is a tool from linear algebra that is very well known, has many properties, and well, I will not prove them here, but I just assume that, well, this is a decomposition for matrices that is given to us, okay, and you can just use it here, okay, in the context of quantum states. So we do a singular value decomposition. So let's do an SVD of this matrix. And what do we get? Well, we have psi. And well, the singular value decomposition is something that looks like U lambda B daga, okay? With U daga U equals the identity TA times TA and B daga the identity dv times dv. These are the dimensions of the Hilbert spaces for A and B, okay? And this matrix, by the way, is a dA times dv matrix. B daga, sorry. And then lambda, the singular value decomposition tells us that lambda is diagonal, real and larger than zero, okay? So it has positive entries, and we know that these are called singular values. And as you know, they are really, really important. Exactly. Now this matrix lambda is a matrix that is chi times chi, with chi upper bounded by the minimum of PA. This is just given to us. This is the singular value decomposition.
Yes, it can be zero.
Yes, it could be zero. This is why I put an upper bound. What is it? Here. Okay? This is why I put an upper bound, because it could be that you have some null eigenspace. Singular space. Okay? This is just to be completely general. Okay? Well, so we assume that this is given to us. This is in all the books of linear algebra from I don't know when. From the old times, and well, now we do quantum information, and we say, well, we can just put this thing here and see what comes up, okay? And this is what we do. So we pick up the singular value decomposition and put it in a quantum state. So at the level of coefficients, this is psi ij, means that this is the sum for alpha equals 1 and beta equals 1 up to VA for VB of ui alpha lambda alpha beta beta j. And how much is that? Well, let's just remember that lambda is diagonal, so that lambda alpha beta is some diagonal element times the delta, Kronecker delta. And then I have a delta, I have a sum, and one of the sum cancels, and then we end up with sum alpha equals 1 up to chi of u, chi alpha, lambda alpha, beta alpha j. Okay? Okay. I didn't do anything, I just rewrote the same equation but with coefficients. Okay. And now, we pick up this equation and put it there in the expression for the quantum state. Okay? And what we get is the following, psi AB equals, what is it here? So we have sum for I equals 1 to dA. I just write it explicitly, sum for j equals 1 up to dB. And then I have psi ij, but psi ij is the sum. So what I just put it, so I have the sum alpha equals 1 up to pi, ui alpha lambda alpha lambda. Alpha j, and now I have the vectors, no? So I for a, j for b. Okay? So this guy here, this is psi ij. And now the next step is, to rearrange these sums. I'm going to put the sum over alpha here, outside. I'm going to rearrange the sums over I and j. And then what you get is the following. You have sum alpha equals 1 to chi. And then I have lambda alpha. And then first I put the sum over i's. I equals 1 up to dA of u, I, alpha, and then this guy also has an i, so I a, sum j plus 1, b, daga, alpha j, j, b. Okay? It's the same equation, but I just rearrange the sums. And what is this? This is just a change of basis, okay? So this is a unitary operator acting on some basis, and this gives me back another basis labeled by alpha, okay? And then the same thing here, but with respect to beta and part B, okay? So I just call this quantum alpha A, and by construction they are going to be also some normal basis, and I call this alpha B, because they are labeled by this index, okay? Alpha and alpha. And then that's it. Then what we have is sum alpha equals 1 up to chi of lambda alpha, quantum state alpha A, quantum state alpha B. That's it. Okay? The lambdas are real and positive coefficients. They correspond to the singular values of the matrix of the coefficients. And at the level of quantum information, we call them the Smith coefficients. Okay, so the Smith coefficients and the singular values, I mean, they are exactly the same thing. Okay. Very important is that in the Smith decomposition, these bases are orthonormal. Okay, this is going to play a role when we start talking about tensor networks. Okay, they must be orthonormal, otherwise you don't have a Smith decomposition. I don't know, something else. Questions? Connecting to the previous statement, this decomposition is unique up to some phase definitions of these vectors, because you could always multiply them by some phase. Okay, so say you could multiply these guys by minus one, okay, and these ones also, and nothing will change. Okay. Okay. So this is the Smith decomposition. What else could I say about this? This is the reason why there is a connection between the Smith decomposition and the singular value decomposition. Okay, so the singular value decomposition in the end, when we play with that, is gonna be nothing but just you can understand the Smith decomposition simply from the singular value decomposition of the matrix of coefficients. That's the reason why both of them are connected. Good.
Is there an algorithmic way to find these bases?
There is.
So
who is asking? Where are you? Oh, you, yes. Precisely the same algorithms to find the singular value decomposition.
Okay.
Those are the ones applied to find it. Okay. More questions? No? Makes a funny noise, huh? Okay.
So I guess if you have a infinite dimensional system and
yes,
first regularize with some UV cutoff or something.
Yeah, well, in the case of an infinite dimensional system, this thing goes up to infinity, so you have a basis that is infinite dimensional, and your Smith rank can be infinite. Okay, but there is also a Smith decomposition.
Yes,
So you can generalize this thing also for infinite dimensional Hilbert space. More questions? Okay. Good. Now let's talk about the following question: how to quantify entanglement. So we know that entanglement is there. We know that it's a non-separability of the wave function. And at least for a bipartite system, we kind of more or less see that it's connected to the Smith decomposition. Okay? And now comes the question, well, how can we quantify entanglement? Okay, we like to have a measure, objective measure, that we just apply it to a quantum state and it tells us the degree of entanglement that we have. Before starting talking about entropies and things like this, there is a very simple measure that comes out from the Smith decomposition, and that's the Smith rank, this guy. Okay? So, just to begin with, we could think of quantifying entanglement with chi. Okay, this is the Smith rank. Right? And this is a measure of entanglement. Okay, it satisfies, the people in quantum information have taken their time to define properly what a measure of entanglement should be. It's called, it should satisfy the properties of something called entanglement monotones, okay? It should not increase under something that they call local operations and classical communication, which basically is local operations on every side. There are other properties, and the Smith rank satisfies them. Okay, so the Smith rank, this chi, is a measure of entanglement. If it is one, the state is separable. If it's larger than one, the state is entangled. Just like that. Okay, so chi larger than one means entanglement. of course, the larger the Smith rank, you could say that, well, the more entangled is the state. Okay? But that's a little bit dangerous anyway. Now, there is a problem with this measure of entanglement, which is that it's discontinuous. Okay? It goes on steps. So the Smith rank is a natural number. It's either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. But it cannot be pi divided by the square root of 2. Okay? So this thing is not continuous, and that's a problem, okay? It's a problem because, in practice, we would like to have something continuous to take derivatives and, apply all the machinery of differential calculus, okay, to be able to integrate it and so on and so forth. So, but this is not continuous, okay? It's something that, just discrete like this. So there is another measure of entanglement. Actually, there are many. But the one that I will be talking about all the time here, and probably also most of the other lectures, is the von Neumann entropy. Okay? So the Smith rank is a measure of entanglement, and the von Neumann entropy is also a measure of entanglement. And the definition is So, row A equals minus 3 of row A log row A, and this is the same as S of row B. Now, row A and row B, these are the reduced density matrices for A and B, respectively, okay? And that's row A. And well, this is the bipartite quantum state. And the same for row B, but doing the partial trace over A. Okay? Is it clear how to compute a reduced density matrix? Yes? Yes, fine. I assume that yes, this is more or less basic quantum mechanics. Okay? You do the partial trace over the other subsystem, which means that, well, you just do like the trace, okay, but only with regarding the index of the subsystem that you are not considering, okay? You trace it out. Good. So this is the von Neumann entropy. And since it's a measure of entanglement, people also call it entanglement entropy. And, well, it has this very, very nice formula, and if I diagonalize row A, okay, what I find is the following. I have another expression, so if I call nu alpha eigenvalues of row A, and by the way, they are also the eigenvalues of row B, that I will explain in a second, then the formula that I get is S of row A, this is equal to minus sum alpha equals 1 to chi nu alpha nu alpha, and this is what I get. I'm putting here chi not by chance. I'm putting there chi because, as I will tell you in a second, it's exactly the same chi that comes out from the Smith decomposition. Okay, it's the Smith graph. So, from the point of view of the eigenvalues of the reduced density matrix, this is nothing but the Shannon entropy of classical information theory of the distribution of probabilities given by the eigenvalues of the reduced density matrix. That's what it is. Okay? So this is the Shannon entropy of the eigenvalues. Okay, that's entanglement entropy, or the von Neumann entropy, and that's the definition, okay? Now we know about the Smith decomposition, okay? Because I just defined it to you. And it means that, well, if I want to compute those reduced density matrices in the Smith basis, turns out that there is a very convenient expression for that. So, you know, moreover, we have the following properties. We have that row A can actually be written like sum over alpha equals 1 up to chi of modulus lambda alpha squared alpha alpha for A, and row B, this is the sum alpha equals 1 up to chi modulus alpha squared alpha alpha for B. Okay? So what did I do here? I just took my arbitrary bipartite state, wrote it in terms of the Smith decomposition, and then computed the two reduced density matrices, okay? Directly in the Smith basis. So I do the partial trace over one of the subsystems, and I do it using the Smith basis, okay? Instead of just the, I don't know, whatever basis that they give me, I use the Smith basis, and what I find are these two formulas, okay? For A and B. And this is very good because you know, they are already diagonal, okay? So the Smith basis is an eigenbasis of the reduced density matrices, okay? And, you know, because it's just the sum of these projectors. And moreover, the eigenvalues are the Smith coefficients squared. Okay? That's why it's also important, right? Because if you find the Smith decomposition, then you have the reduced density matrices for free. So they are diagonal in the Smith basis. And the eigenvalues, mu alpha that I was writing there, they are just the Smith coefficients squared. Just like that. And now, for somebody that is not very familiar with this, comes the typical question. I mean, you see these and you say, well, but these are not the same reduced density matrices, right? And the answer is no, okay? They have the same eigenvalues, projectors are different, okay? Because this is only a label to some vector, okay? So they could be very different vectors in the respective Hilbert spaces, but they share the same eigenvalues, okay? In fact, that's very important. Both row A and row B have the same rank, okay? And also the eigenvalues are the same. And that's a very important property. You can have the reduced density matrix, so you can have an entangled system, you can have an electron entangled with the rest of the universe, and if your electron is a spin 1/2, has a spin 1/2 and only has a Hilbert space dimension 2, the rest of the universe will only have two eigenvalues in the reduced density matrix. Okay? Even if it has, I don't know, all the atoms in the universe. Right? So they have the same rank and the eigenvalues are the same. And now comes a little bit of an intuitive idea, which is that, well, we know that entanglement, I didn't mention that, but it's a property that is important in quantum information science, because in quantum information we understand entanglement as a resource. Okay? The same thing as I don't know, energy is a resource, or money is also a resource. Right? Time is also a resource, so it's something that if you have it, you can just use it to do something else, okay? To, I don't know, to manipulate it. So entanglement is also a resource in quantum information. We can use it to do, for instance, teleportation between here and some other galaxy, or we can use it to do exponentially fast quantum algorithms, we can use it to do quantum cryptography, and so on and so forth. So it's more than a property of nature, it's a resource, okay? So, it's a resource that is non-local in the sense that it's a correlation that is not hidden, say, in Hilbert space A or Hilbert space B. Say, if I have two entangled particles or two entangled spins, it's a correlation that is not in one spin or the other. It's something that is really putting the two subsystems together, but not at the level of the physical space. It's putting the two subsystems together at the level of the Hilbert space. Okay, so it's really a non-local correlation. It's not in one place or the other. It's somewhere in between. Okay, and it really belongs to both of them. So if we are now quantifying entanglement, whatever measure that I compute, it can only depend on properties that are the same for both subsystems. Okay, it could not depend on something that is specific of one system or the other. And here, at the level of really quantum mechanics, the only properties that are shared by the two systems are the rank of the reduced density matrices and the eigenvalues. Okay? So whichever measure of entanglement that I can more or less imagine, that I can compute, it's gonna depend only on this and nothing else. Because this is the thing that is common to both subsystems, no matter how far they are from each other. So this non-local correlation needs to be hidden here. Okay? In this spectrum of eigenvalues. And this is the reason why, well, this entanglement entropy depends on the eigenvalues, and the Smith rank is also a measure of entanglement because it's also a common property of the two subsystems. Okay? That's where the correlation has to be hidden. It has to be there. Okay? Good. Well, that was more or less an intuitive explanation of all this is mathematics, but I mean, physically, this is what it means. Okay? And later, when I tell you that quantum many body systems satisfy an area law for the entanglement entropy, the area between the block of your system and the rest of the environment is the shared property in physical space between both of them. Okay? So entanglement has to be there, it has to be at the boundary. Okay? This is the reason why we have an area law and so on and so forth. And this distribution of eigenvalues will also be connected to some properties of the area. Okay? So that's the physical intuition why this happens. Okay. Good. So that's the reduced density matrix, that's the von Neumann entropy. Some other properties of the von Neumann entropy, we also have that this is upper bounded by log chi. This is easy to prove. But you just look for the bipartite states that maximize this quantity with some Lagrange multipliers and so on, and you find this upper bound. And this is saturated by this quantum state. This is psi AB equals, let's put a max. Actually, let me put here a phi plus AB. This is 1 over the square root of chi, sum alpha equals 1 up to chi, and then we have alpha for A, alpha for B. This is what the people call a maximally entangled state. Okay? So, what the distribution of, well, I don't have it here, but the point is, when my Smith coefficients become a flat distribution, then I have a maximal entangled state. Okay? So let's put it in other words. So if I have a distribution of the Smith coefficients that looks like this, up to chi, so the entanglement entropy of this guy is going to be larger than the entanglement entropy of, I don't know, something that looks like this. Okay. So this could be, I don't know, an exponential decay of the Smith coefficients, and this is actually what happens for the ground state of a gap quantum many body system in 1D. You have an exponential decay of the Smith coefficients. But if you have a flat distribution, then you have a maximal entangled state, and your entropy is very, very high. Okay? That's intuition. Okay, let me add, just to conclude this topic of entanglement, that the entanglement entropy, I mean, the reason why people always talk about the entanglement entropy essentially, I mean, people also talk about other measures of entanglement, okay? But the entanglement entropy is special, okay? And the reason why it's special is because it's the only measure that satisfies three properties, namely that is invariant under what the people in quantum information call LOCC, and this is local operations and classical communication. Okay, is invariant under LOCC. Sorry, invariant, no. That does not increase. This is wrong. Does not increase under LOCC. It's also continuous and additive. Okay?
Remind.
Yes?
What about Rényi entropies, for instance?
They are not additive.
But they do not increase under local.
That's also true.
Yes.
They do not increase. Yeah, yeah, no. What I'm saying is that entanglement entropy is the only one that satisfies the three of them at the same time. Okay? So I was going to make that connection now. So if you have these three, I mean, if you assume that you want a measure of entanglement with these three properties, this not increase under LOCC, it means that if you act locally on your particle here or locally on the other particle there, even if you do measurements and say you try to correlate classically the both subsystems by, I don't know, picking up the phone and calling your friend in the other galaxy and telling the result of your measurement, and then the other guy is doing something else, well, that is a classical communication. So if you do all these things, this entanglement does not increase, okay? Now the second condition is to be continuous, so the Smith rank was not continuous, so we want it to be continuous. And the third one is additivity, okay? It means that, well, if you have two decoupled systems and now you want to know the entanglement entropy of some bipartition, then it's the sum of the two, okay? If you drop the third assumption, so without additivity, turns out that there are many other measures of entanglement. So you have, for instance, as I was mentioning now, the Rennie entropies, which are also very, very popular, and they are, so, in some sense, easier to compute with tensor networks than entropy sometimes. They satisfy the first two conditions, but not the third one, but it's still okay. I mean, they are also a measure of entanglement, but they are not additive, okay? And other things, there are other measures of entanglement that people have proposed, but they are not additive. Now, this is the reason why the entanglement entropy is so interesting. More questions? Or remarks, or wishes, or provocations? Yeah?
So to be the maximum entangled state, the chi doesn't need to be the maximum, right?
No, I mean, to be maximally entangled, I mean, yeah, I mean, this is a maximally entangled state for a fixed chi. So if you fix chi, the distribution of Smith coefficients that maximizes the entanglement entropy is the flat distribution.
Sure.
This is what it means. Now, chi is upper bounded by the minimum of these Hilbert space dimensions, and therefore you saturate it when you reach the smallest Hilbert space dimension. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. More questions?
How do you find locality of operations?
How do you define locality of operations?
Yes, yeah, so these are just...
Well, that's very easy. So. Imagine that these two guys are entangled, okay? And I have this guy and you have the other guy. And now I operate on my guy here, and that's a local operation, okay? It's something that I do locally here without affecting the other.
So these are unitary operations? So
yes.
One of the two.
Exactly, that's what I mean by local.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and classical communication is just, I make a measurement here, and then I basically classically...
Yeah, well, a measurement is also a local operation.
Okay.
So the classical communication is... Okay. Yeah, sending a postcard to your friend, or sending classical bits of information to try to correlate classically what's in. Okay?
What is the mathematical definition of
additivity?
Additivity.
Yes. What it means is the following. So if you want to compute the entanglement entropy of psi AB tensor phi A prime B prime, it should be the entanglement entropy coming from psi plus the entanglement entropy coming from phi A prime B prime. I mean, I'm thinking of something like, let's see, this is A, B, A prime, B prime. Now these two guys are in some state psi, and these two guys are in some state phi. And now I do this by partition. Okay? That's what I mean. It's going to be the entropy of, you know, this piece plus this piece. Bless you.
Thank you.
Okay? This is a B prime, sorry. Yes?
I still don't understand what the classical communication means. It's easy to understand that if you apply local unitary operations to A, alpha A, and alpha B, then result in the function exactly has the same entanglement. But then what does classical
communication
mean?
This is because we have pure states here. So the most general definition of entanglement is for mixed states, okay? So for actual reduced density matrices of A and B. And there, this classical communication plays a role. Because you can also, you can write a separable reduced density matrix that still has classical correlations. I mean, a thermal state, for instance. Okay. And this is the reason why they introduced this classical communication there. For pure states, it's trivial. I mean, if you do a measurement, even if you communicate, nothing happens. But for mixed states, there is a difference.
I see.
Okay. More questions? No? Okay, so now you know a lot about entanglement. Okay, so the second point of this lecture is going to be super brief. I mean, it's so brief, it's just 3 lines, okay? Brief review of how entanglement behaves in 1D quantum many body systems. This is going to be very brief because, I mean, Glenn already explained that very well. So he explained that if you have a gap system, and also Marie-Carmen, if you have a gap system in 1D, then entanglement operates in, you compute the entanglement of a block and it's saturated by a constant. If it's a critical system, then you have a logarithmic divergence and it's what corresponds to something called conformal field theory. If you have a two-dimensional system, then you may have an area law. If you have a 2D critical system of fermions, let's say, you will have logarithmic corrections to the area law and so on and so forth. So there are many results there, but here I'm only focusing on 1D because later I want to explain matrix flow distance. Okay? And instead of starting with the casuistics of what happens if you pick up the XY model at this particular quantum phase transition and what are the critical exponents and so on, I'm giving you directly the general results. Okay? So the general result, this is kind of the guidance that I will follow. This is obtained using conformal field theory. Now, how many of you know what a conformal field theory is? Okay, well, you know. Okay, how many of you know what a field theory is without the conformal thing?
Depends on the level of
what. Well, you know what is a field operator, let's say? Have you ever seen the, I don't know, some field operator? Yeah. Anyway, so a conformal field theory is a field theory that has a special property that is called conformal symmetry. Okay, now let's go step by step. So first of all, a field theory is a description of a system in the continuum. That's why we call it a field, okay? So you start with, I don't know, a discrete system of spins, and you start having a look from very, very far away, and in the end you cannot distinguish the spins, and you can describe your system with a field, okay? Therefore you have a quantum field theory. Now, if this field theory has a particular symmetry that is called conformal, then we say that it's a conformal field theory. And this conformal symmetry is essentially Lorentz invariance, which is the typical invariance that we have in the universe, you know, rotation, boost transformations, and these kind of things, and scale transformations, okay? So when you have a scale invariance on top of the usual invariance and the rotations and so on, then we have another group, okay? That is called the conformal group. There is another transformation that is called a special conformal transformation, but it comes out from the other. But the point is that if we have a scale invariance, then we have conformal symmetry, and we can describe our system most of the time with a conformal field theory. Okay? Now, a scale invariance is exactly what happens at the critical point of a quantum many body system. Okay? So you tune your magnetic field of the Hamiltonian, and suddenly you pop. You have an infinite correlation length somewhere because you have a quantum critical point, and therefore you don't have any scale in your system because the only scale that you have is infinite, right? And then the system is a scale invariant, okay? And that's the reason why you have scale invariance, and therefore it means that if you start coarse graining your system, it doesn't matter how many times you coarse grain it, you always see the same thing, okay? That's a scale invariant. So from conformal field theory, which is a very complicated mathematical framework to analyze all these things, one gets the following result. So if I have a 1D quantum many-body system, And it could be spins, but if I have a loop from very far away, I can describe it with this field theory. Okay? And I want to compute, you know, I have the ground state, psi 0. This is the ground state. And now I want to compute the reduced density matrix of a block of length L, typical situation. And from here, I want to compute the entanglement entropy of the block. I call it SL. Okay? Now, the general result is that for L much larger than 1, we have the following results. So S of L, it goes asymptotically like C over 3. I will later say what is this 3, this C. Block of L at a quantum phase transition. And S of L goes asymptotically, you know, to subleading corrections and constants and so on, like C over 3 log of the correlation length, close to the quantum phase transition. Okay? Now, this parameter C is what the people call the central charge. And I guess you've seen maybe this formula a few times already, and it appeared at least yesterday, and this is what it means. So let's think for a second about these two formulas. First of all, C is a number that depends on the conformal field theory, okay? It means it depends on the particular model that you have. It's called the central charge, and it's kind of, well, you could understand it as some kind of critical exponent, okay? It's something that defines, it depends on what type of system do you have, okay? On the universality class of your system. Good. Now, the first equation here, what it means is that when you are at a quantum critical point, when you start increasing the size of your block, entanglement grows up indefinitely. Okay, and it grows like a log. Okay? It grows like a logarithm. And this is telling you that if you move away from the quantum phase transition, therefore you have a scale, and you open a gap in your system, and you have a gap quantum many body system in 1D, blah, blah, blah. Then what happens is that, well, you can start increasing the size of your system, and at some point it saturates in a constant. Okay? And this constant is going to be given by something that has to do with the correlation length. Okay? Now, if entanglement of a block saturates in a constant, what it means is that what we have is an area law in 1D. Okay? Because in 1D, an area law is being a constant, because, you know, my area, you know, the area between the block and the environment is only 2 points. So, you know, if entanglement doesn't grow, it means that we have a 1D area law. Okay? That's important. So if you have a gap, non-critical quantum many-body system in 1D, then we have a 1D area law, okay? Which means that entanglement saturates in some constant. And if we are at a quantum critical point, then we no longer have an area law, we have a logarithmic violation of the area law, which means that, well, entanglement grows up logarithmically with the size of the block. It means that the structure of entanglement in these two situations is going to be very different. In one, we have an area law, and the other, we don't have. Okay? Questions? Of course, this can be, you know, reproduced with many numerical experiments. So if you now pick up the XY model, or the, say, the 1D quantumizing model, and you put, I don't know, magnetic field equals 1, you are at a quantum critical point, and you start studying this entanglement entropy, you will see that there is this logarithmic divergence, and in particular for the Ising model, this C is equal to 1/2. Okay? If you do the same thing for the 1D Heisenberg model, which is also gapless, you have an infinite correlation length, it's a critical model, then you get the same type of scaling, and C is equal to 1. Okay? It means that the conformal field theory is describing one or the other. They are different. I mean, to be more precise, in the case of the Ising model, you can map it to a theory of fermions. And in the case of the Heisenberg model, essentially what you have is two decoupled fermions, okay, and it's like having a boron, okay? So this is the reason why they behave differently, okay? But there are many, many different things that you will study in the numerically. Good. So this was very brief. As I said, it was only to sketch the reason why, a kind of a justification of what I will explain now. So if we have a gap quantum many body system, we have a 1D area law. If we have a critical quantum many body system, then we have a logarithmic correction. Okay? Now, point three, and here is where the fun starts, is matrix product states. So this has been defined already a few times, but let me just define it once again because it's, you know, it's never too much to repeat things, and particularly matrix product states are very, very important. So as I will justify in a second, matrix product states are a particular tensor network. You already know what it is, a tensor network. And that describes pretty well this situation here, okay? The case of a gap 1D quantum many body system, because in particular, we have also a 1D area law. Now, if we have a gap, if we have a critical 1D system where we have a logarithmic violation of the area law, you will see that, well, in principle, matrix product states are not capturing this structure of entanglement, and you could use it, okay? This is what people do when they do DMRG close to a quantum critical point. But if you want to do something that really captures this structure of entanglement, then you have to do other things, and then you have these meta tensor networks that Glenn was explaining yesterday, okay? And so on and so forth. So let's define what is a matrix product state. So, well, first, I'm going to go a bit quick here, since you already know this diagrammatic notation, okay? We've been playing with it already for this week. So this is the coefficient of the quantum many-body wave function. And a matrix product state is breaking this guy into a one-dimensional array of tensors, just like that. Okay, so it's a 1D tensor network. So I'm not defining what a tensor network is because you already know. I'm also not saying what these indices mean. Is this is clear to everybody? Yes, no? I mean, we've been playing with that already during the week. Okay. Now we have two different types of dimensions here. We have something that we call the bond dimension of the MPS, and this guy goes from 1 up to chi. And I'm not using this letter, but just by chance. Okay? Later you will see that this is exactly the Schmidt rank of some bipartitions. Okay? And then we have the physical dimension, which I just say goes from 1 up to p. So if I have spin 1 half, then p is equal to 2, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, what is the motivation for introducing matrix product states? There are several motivations. Motivation zero is that, well, here I have an exponential number of parameters, whereas here I have a polynomial number of parameters. So it's a more efficient description of a quantum many-body wave function. Okay? So in particular, I have of the order n parameters, and that's already a good motivation, but this is the size of the system. That's a motivation zero. We have something that, well, is efficient, okay? It fits in the computer, right? motivation one is that you can understand a matrix product state as a generalization of mean field. So a typical mean field approximation is to say that, well, we don't have any correlation between the sides, and therefore we just have a product state. Okay? That could be a mean field approximation. So mean field approximation means zero correlation. We'll see that it means zero entanglement. If I just want to generalize this, I just start adding some indices here. I promote these vectors to tensors, and then I get a matrix product state. Okay? And it's still efficient, but now it's correlated. So this could also be a motivation to deal with MPS. Now, motivation two is that it can be seen as a collection of singlets with projectors. And I think this is a picture that Marie Kaunen mentioned yesterday in her talk, in some slide. The point is the following. Imagine that we have this construction. Okay, and what are these guys? Well, these guys are maximal integral states. Let's call it phi plus. Sometimes I call them singlets, because the singlet of SU2 is a maximal integral state also. Okay, so sometimes the people call singlets and so on, but what I mean is that we have maximal integral states. And now, well, I add some projectors on these pairs of, you know, virtual particles. Okay, these are projectors P. And the matrix elements of these projectors, so phi plus is something that looks like 1 over the square root of chi, sum of the poles 1 up to chi, and then we have something like alpha. Alpha, these are for some virtual particles. And I call them virtual because now I project them and I get some real physical particle. Okay? So P, the matrix elements of this guy, I alpha beta are these ones, and then I have I alpha beta, and this is projector. Okay? This projects the two virtual particles into a physical one. Okay, so this is physical, these are virtual, and I, well, in principle I could do this construction. Now if you do this, you just have a set of maximal entangled states and now you project things, okay, into some physical subspaces. What comes out from here is a matrix proper state. Okay, you end up having something like this, and the coefficients of the tensors are nothing but the coefficients of the projectors. So your matrices in your MPS are this piece, okay? And this is an MPS by construction. It's not just an MPS by construction; it's an arbitrary MPS. You can write every MPS like this, okay? This is the reason why when you promote this thing to two dimensions, you call this projected entangled pair state instead of two-dimensional tensor product state. Or, I don't know, people also call it TPS, okay? But this is the reason why they also call it projected entangled pair state. Because you have entangled pairs and you project them just like that. This picture of what's an MPS is very useful if you want to understand, say, some properties connected to quantum information, but it's, well, it's also a nice interpretation. And motivation 3 is that it can be understood in terms of a sequential, instead of sequential, in terms of sequential Smith decompositions. And this is probably more connected to what you guys do, okay, or what you may be doing at some point in quantum many body systems. And I think Glenn also explained this very well, so I will go a bit fast with this. So if we have an arbitrary wave function, just like that, I could just think of, you know, doing the Smith decomposition of the first particle versus the rest. Now, at the level of the tensor, for the wave function, we have seen that the Smith decomposition is the same thing as doing the singular value decomposition in the tensor. Okay? So what we do is an SVD here, and that effectively implements the Smith decomposition, but in the tensor. Okay? But it's the Smith decomposition, it's what I explained at the beginning. So, you know, I just paint it like that. And well, this is gonna be some rotation, okay? Some coefficients to rotate to the corresponding Smith basis for the first particle, and these are my Smith coefficients. I call them lambda 1, but they are also the singular value. Okay, it's the same thing. And now I do the same thing here, and then I get something like this. Okay, and this is gamma 1 lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 2. And I keep doing this thing. And in the end, I end up having something like this, with lambda 1, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 2, lambda 3, ta ta ta, until lambda n minus 1, lambda n. Now, if all the Smith ranks are bounded by some constant, then what we have is an MPS, okay? So if we say that all the Smith ranks is less than or equal to some constant chi, then what we have is an MPS by construction. This is what happens in slightly entangled quantum states. So, and this is, for instance, the situation of I mean, this cannot happen for every state, okay? Sometimes this Smith rank will blow up exponentially. But say, if you are in the ground state of a 1D quantum many body system and you do this sequential Smith decomposition according to the natural ordering that you are given, okay? Then you see that this is actually bounded by a constant, okay? Or can be approximated very well by something that is bounded by a constant, to be more precise. Okay, and therefore, what you have is a matrix plot state. Okay. In particular, this is an MPS in canonical form. Okay, which is a particular way of writing MPS, where the Smith coefficients corresponding to all these bipartitions are explicit. Okay, this is an MPS in canonical form. It also connects to what Mari Carmen was saying yesterday. You can define the canonical form in terms of you know, some properties of your transfer matrix operator, blah, 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 and its exalutes. Okay? So the canonical form is defined as you know, the MPS such that when I do a splitting with respect to one index, here I have the Smith coefficients, and what I have to the left and to the right are the Smith bases. And the Smith bases are orthonormal bases. Okay, therefore, if I do a scalar product of vectors in the orthonormal basis, I get deltas. Okay, that's the definition. If I have just an arbitrary MPS, normally it doesn't have this property, but if you write it like this, then you have the property. So you have left and right orthonormal Smith basis. Okay. Now, let me tell you about a couple of properties of MPS that are quite important. the first is that there is a rich invariance. Well, this is in fact general for every tensor network, but here you can see it very clearly. If we have these tensors, A and B, this is equal to, you know, doing something like that, A, X, X minus 1, B. And now if I contract these two guys together and these two guys together, what I get is a different tensor network in terms of some different tensors, but the state is the same. Okay? So there is a gauge degree of freedom, which here is very clear, that in the sense that, well, I can just use different tensors and I still have the same quantum state. Okay? This is the reason why the people defend canonical forms and so on, because it's a way of fixing the gauge. Now, this is property one. And well, by the way, this has some implications, but I will not explain it here. Property two is that the entanglement entropy of a block, and this is easy to prove, is upper-bounded by two block chi. I will prove this tomorrow for PEPS, which is even more difficult, okay? And then for MPS is gonna be very easy. So what is this? This is a 1D area law. And that's exactly what we had for the entanglement entropy of a gapped quantum many body system in 1D. We had a 1D area law. At some point, you know, entanglement saturates in a constant, okay? That depends on the correlation length. And that's exactly what MPS are giving us. We can have something that saturates in a pump. So it rings a bell that, well, maybe this class of states is good for describing these type of systems. You can do things like open boundary conditions. So for instance, I could define an MPS like this. You can also do periodic boundary conditions. It's very easy. You just have one more link. Oops, just like that. You can do infinite systems. Well, you just have the same tensor repeated everywhere, or some unit cell that is repeated everywhere, and so on. Okay? And then the last property, and this, I will spend the last part of today proving this, is that the correlation length is finite. Okay? And this is also what happens for gamma. So MPS, by construction, always have a finite correlation. Okay? And this should ring a bell again to gap 1D systems, because this is exactly what happens in a gap 1D system. You have a finite correlation length, and you have a 1D area law. And this is precisely what MPS are giving you. So it's like, okay, so it looks like we are capturing the correct structure of the timing here. Good. Now let me prove how one extracts this correlation length, because I think it's a very nice example of the type of manipulations that one has to play with normally with matrix product states. And that's very useful when you have to try to understand other types of structures like mirrors, pairs, and so on and so forth. So let's prove this. So let's start like follows. We define the correlation function as, well, the expectation value of some operator outside I, and then some other operator O prime outside I plus R minus the disconnected one. Okay? Expectation value of I, expectation value of O prime, I plus R. And I want to see how this correlation function decays with the distance. Okay? If it decays exponentially fast, it's going to have a finite correlation length. If it decays only polynomially fast, the correlation length is infinite. And O and O prime are just some arbitrary operators acting on one side. So, well, my MPS, I just assume, just for the sake of simplicity, that it can be generalized to situations that I have an infinite MPS with the same tensor A everywhere. But we could do different structures, okay? But this is the simplest one, and I assume also that they have a finite bond dimension. It's given by Kite. Okay, so the bond dimension of the MPS, as you have already seen, it has to do with the rank of the Smith decompositions, blah blah. Then I call it Kite. Good. Then let's start painting all the diagrams for this. Okay, so C of R is gonna be, well, first we have this expectation value, and this is, in the MPS, this expectation value divided by the norm, because it's normalized, okay? So the quantum state must be normalized. So let's see what we will have in here. So we have something that looks like this. Yeah, I could just go on. Tensor A, this is A star, because this is what comes from the complex conjugate. And now here is operator O, this is operator O prime, this is the distance R. Okay? That's the numerator for this first piece. Okay? And now the denominator is the same contraction but without the operators, because it's only the norm. Okay? So I just paint it like that. Okay, so this guy from here, this is the epsilon. This is the norm. So this is this piece. Okay, the first piece. Is this clear? Yeah? And now I'm going to paint the second. So minus well, what do you have in the denominator? I'm going to have the norm squared, because you know I have expectation values, so I have the same tensor network, but squared. Okay? And in the numerator, I have something like this, but with just one operator. Okay? So I just get it. Like this. And like this, it is O prime. Okay? The translation from here to here, is it clear? I see funny faces, huh? But, so this is the quantum state, okay? This is psi, and if I paint it like that, this is the bra, and this is with A star. Okay, and a one-body operator is just something acting on the physical states. It's just a matrix, okay? This could be the Pauli matrix, okay? For a spin 1/2, right? Now this is the tensor network contraction that I have to do. I have to do all these multiplications, and you know, using ENCON, for instance, that was mentioning Glenn, you could compute this, and this is what corresponds to this correlation. Okay. Well, now we define. Let's see. We see that there is a structure here that is being repeated many times, which is this contraction. Okay. And I define this as the transfer matrix of the MPS. So. This object, I call it E of the identity, which is essentially for historical reasons. This is this contractor, AA star, and this is the MBS transfer matrix. It's called a matrix, even though it has four indices, because if you just consider left and right, and you join this, this is for left and the right together, then it's a matrix, okay, with respect to left and right. And it's called transfer matrix because it's a thing that is propagating the information along this direction. Exactly the same thing as the usual transfer matrix in a statistical mechanics. Good. But then we see that in terms of this object, actually the norm, this is nothing but the limit when I go to infinity of the trace of this operator to the power of n. You know, I multiply this operator n times, and I take n going to infinity, and that's the norm, okay? So this is an example of why this operator is important. So that's a way of writing the norm. Now, let me do the eigenvalue decomposition. Okay. Of this transfer matrix, and this is sum mu equals 1 up to chi squared. There are up to chi squared eigenvalues because this is a chi squared times chi squared matrix. Okay? And well, I just call the eigenvalues omega, and the eigenvectors, I call them r mu. And this looks like a ket, but no, because well, I'm using these parentheses, okay? So there is no corner here, this is rounded. Just to make the distinction that this is not an actual physical Hilbert space. Okay, this is just a vector, r mu, and m mu, right? So these are the right and left eigenvectors, and the normalization is just that l mu r nu, this is equal to delta v nu. And these eigenvalues are sorted into decreasing order, okay? And so on, in absolute value. That's just the eigenvalue decomposition, so pretty standard for matrices. Then, if I take powers of this guy, ei to the power of n, so I can always write this. If I take the largest, so the eigenvalue with the largest absolute value outside, this is omega 1 to the power of m, sum mu equals 1 up to chi squared, omega 2 over omega 1. To the power of m, r mu, l mu, OK? Okay, and I assume that omega 1 is non-degenerate. Now, this assumption is not too strong. I mean, I could also consider the case in which the largest, the eigenvalue with the largest absolute value is also degenerate, but well, I mean, this is also, this is the simplest case, okay? So let's do it like this. And we could also generalize things later. So now if m is very large, now we see what is going to happen here, which is that this thing is going to decrease exponentially fast, okay? Because this ratio is smaller than 1 in absolute value. So that I can approximate this, say, by the first two contributions. So for m much larger than 1, what we have is that this guy to the power of m, this is approximately omega 1 m, and then we have something like r1 l1 plus the contribution of the second eigenvalue to the power of m, and the second eigenvalue in principle it could be degenerate, so well, I just introduce an index for the degeneracy r mu m mu, and this is the degeneracy of omega 2. Very simple, I just define this transfer matrix, diagonalize it, and now when I take the powers, when I take many powers, this essentially goes to the eigenvector with the largest eigenvalue in absolute value, and this is the first, this is the contribution, and this is the first correction. Okay? And now what we do is, well, pick up this guy and put it in the tensor network that I just removed from the blackboard, and see what happens. And what happens is the following. What happens is that, well, one can see that this guy can actually be approached, which was the first contribution that I painted here, can actually be written as the following tensor network. Okay. And this is A star, A star, O prime, this is R1 divided by omega 1 squared. Now the contributions from numerator and denominator, even though we have an infinite system, they cancel out, okay, when you insert this thing, and they cancel out exactly, and the only finite piece that remains is this, plus a contribution from the second eigenvalue, which is omega 2 divided by omega 1 to the power of I minus 1, sum mu equals 2 up to q, and then we have also something like this, where these guys are L1, R1, but what we have in here is R mu to mu, and this is also divided by omega 1 squared. And all the rest cancels. Looks like black magic, but it is not. You just put it there, and all these infinitely many contributions from the numerator and the denominator, they cancel exactly one by one. Okay, so there is no, there are no infinites left. And this is the only thing that remains. Now, it turns out that this first piece here, this is also what you get also if you compute this expectation value times oi plus r. So the product of the two expectation values of the single set operators is exactly the first piece that you get in here. And the correlator is this guy minus this guy. So the only piece that remains is the second one. Okay? That's the correlator. And therefore, when I continue there, what it means is that c of r is this guy here, okay? But this guy, you know, here is the separation distance, and this is an exponential decay, okay? So I can always write this formally as an exponential decay, something like f of r, a times e to the minus r divided by some correlation length, with a some constant, and for the q, f of r is some function that has modulus, this is modulus 1. Essentially, it's a sine function. It could be, if it's an antiferromagnetic system, then you could have plus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, depending on the site. This is what this function is giving you. And then you have an exponential decay, which is given by this correlation function. Sorry, this exponential here. And the correlation length is given by minus 1 divided by log of the absolute value of omega 2 divided by omega 1.
W2 should be W.
Which one?
It's a W2.
W2?
Yeah.
Exactly, right. It's this one. Because I only consider contributions up to the second eigenvalue. This is why I put an approximate here.
Then why you have just a summation over n?
Oh, because this new, this mu, this is a sum over the degeneracy of W2.
Ah, okay.
So I'm just assuming, okay, it could be degenerate, so yeah. Let's put it there. That's also important. Okay? So this is what you get. And
what
this is
C?
Yes?
What is C?
C.
Just some constant. This in the exponential. Oh, this is R. Okay.
This is R. And this is R divided by C.
Yeah.
Okay? And this is the MPS correlation. And it is finite. You see, by construction, no matter what MPS you have, well, I had some assumptions here, but you can always generalize them. They were not too strong. You always have exponential decay of correlations by construction. Okay. And you always have a finite correlation length, which is given by the eigenvalues, by the first two eigenvalues of the MPS transfer matrix, which is this object that I just defined of contracting A with A star, just like that. Okay, so this means that with MPS you can capture well the correlations of a wrapped 1D quantum measurable system, but not if you are at criticality, because at criticality you have infinite correlation length, and therefore, you know, you can never have it with an MPS because it's always finite. Okay? Good. Okay, so let me give you an exercise. And with that you can play with all this, which is to compute the three-point correlation function. Okay? How much is this guy? R1, R2. And this is the expectation value of Ri, okay. I plus R1, R2, I plus R1 plus R2, divided by, well, the expectation value of the three guys. How much is that? So tomorrow I will be checking how many of you have done that. Okay? If you try to do this, you should see something very nice going on here, which is that you can always decompose this thing in terms of the two-body correlation functions, and then you have something like a Bix theorem for MPS. Okay? I mean, with some subtleties, but it's also like a Bix theorem. Everything depends on your two-body correlation functions. Everything depends on that. And this is also a nice calculation. I mean, what you have to do there is same thing as I did here, but with three operators. Okay? Now, to end this lecture, let me give you an example of an MPS, and then we do the connection with the lecture this afternoon by Masaki Oshikawa, and with that I finished. So an example of MPS, which is kind of an archetypical example, very, very standard, is the AKLT state. And this is the unique ground state of this spin 1 Hamiltonian, H equals sum of I S I S I plus 1 plus 1 over 3 S I times S I square, and this is for spin 1. And the AKLT state is given by the following matrix elements. So this is A and component 0. Well, this is a particular representation. This is sigma z. This is 1, and this is sigma, and excuse me, square root of 2 sigma plus. And if this guy is 2, this is minus the square root of 2 sigma minus. Is that correct? Yes. OK. There are different ways of defining the AKLT state. You can always do gauge transformations in the tensors, and probably this afternoon you will see it defined in some other way. But there is a base redefinition that brings these tensors to this Pauli, to the Pauli matrices. And I find it very nice. Okay. As Masaki will tell you this afternoon, this is an example of something very important, which is called symmetry protected topological order. You will see that it has to do with some degeneracy of singular values on the Smith or Smith coefficients in the MPS canonical form. And yeah, you will see that all these things that I was explaining to you now, they are going to be pretty useful for this afternoon. Okay? Very good. So that was all for today, and tomorrow we'll play with 2D systems. Yeah, thank you. More questions?
So you have physical index 2 instead of minus 1?
Yes. No. Physical index is 3, so it's 0, 1, 2, because it's a spin 1 Hamiltonian.
Yeah, but usually we use 0 plus minus 1.
0 plus minus 1, yeah. Why not? Yeah, why not? For instance. More comments or remarks? Or wishes for tomorrow, or provocations, or
As you approach the quantum critical point, let's say we are just right at the critical point, then of course the correlation length is infinite, but somehow, I mean, these eigenvalues of the transfer matrix somehow carries the information of the scaling dimensions. Are you going to tell us about that, this kind of aspect of tomorrow?
No, I was not going to say about that, but very briefly, what happens when you approach the critical point is that this guy is getting larger and larger, and what it means is that these two eigenvalues get closer and closer. So the gap of the transfer matrix actually goes to zero. Okay? But when this situation happens, the whole picture breaks down because if you have a quantum critical point, then you cannot have an MPS because it doesn't have to start with the correct entanglement. Okay? You don't have the log scaling.
So. Right, but somehow, it's partially carries the information for that.
Yeah, you can get very close to the quantum critical point. And this is the way in which, this is the reason why DMRZ also can give you the information about critical systems, because you get very close to the quantum critical point and you increase your bond dimension by a lot, and then you can more or less extract the properties of the critical point by having a look at what happens close to it. Okay, but then you need a very large bond dimension, because close to the critical point entanglement explodes and you have this log scaling, and therefore you need a very large bond dimension for this. Okay. So if you go to the critical point, and what happens is that you have another structure of entanglement, and this is what the meta is giving you. Mm-hmm. But entanglement is built locally at every length scale. This is what this extra holographic dimension means in the meta.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions?
So can you find some signature of the spontaneous symmetry breaking on the eigenvalue of the transfer matrix?
Yes. Actually, the eigenvalue of the transfer matrix, if the symmetry is not broken, these eigenvalues are degenerate. Okay? And then if you see that there is, when you break the degeneracy, then it means that you have broken the symmetry. For instance, if you have the Ising model with a magnetic field, okay, for an infinite system, or for a finite system, and then you have all the spins up plus all the spins down, you have the exact superposition, If you compute your MPS, you will see that it's actually a direct sum of two matrix group states, one for each sector, okay? And therefore, when you compute the whole thing together, then you have, I mean, you have a degeneracy that is coming from the fact that you have two sectors, okay? And then you have one eigenvalue here and the same eigenvalue there. Yeah. Then you have a small perturbation, you break the symmetry, you collapse in one of the two wave functions, okay? And then your bond dimension suddenly goes to half of it, or half of the one that you had at the beginning, and the degeneracy in the transfer matrix also breaks. And well, what I said was for set to symmetry, but you could generalize that for any other symmetry.
Well, I'm confused that usually the quantum, the symmetry breaking can be only captured in the thermodynamic limit.
Yeah.
So this is just local transfer matrix.
Yeah. Yeah, but it has the non-local information. You see? You have the correlation length there. Okay?
Okay. If there is no further question, I thank the lecturer again.